Welcome to this panel on the refined state, tar sands, pet coke, and the front lines of Great Lakes oil cities, the final installment in the 2016 Oil Water Mix in the Great Lakes series. The series is part of the UIC Freshwater Lab, an endeavor to bring a social, humanistic perspective to bear on pressing water issues. Today is something of an anniversary for the Freshwater Lab, which began just about a year ago at the Water After Borders Summit. It's been a phenomenal first year, and I'd like to say a few words of gratitude and apologies if I forget to express certain words of gratitude. The Freshwater Lab is supported by grants from the Humanities Without Walls Initiative, funded by the Mellon Foundation and housed at the Illinois Program for Research in the Humanities at our sister campus at Urbana-Champaign. Sue Levine and Linda Vavra from this wonderful institution, the UIC Institute for the Humanities, have provided wonderful support and guidance throughout the year, as have partners at the Little Village Environmental Justice Organization, Alliance for the Great Lakes, the Shedd Aquarium, Fjord Corps, the UIC College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, and the UIC Latino Cultural Center. Much gratitude is due to many people, but let me single out Kellen Marshall, Nicole Krause, and Tim Orovec as having helped to bring the Freshwater Lab into being. There's lots more to come next year, including a Freshwater Lab course in the fall, so please leave us your contact information if you'd like to get in touch or be involved. So I have to say, it's one of these moments of correspondence, which I'm sad to announce, but apropos of our topic today, there was an oil spill today in the state of Illinois, and if I get any of the facts wrong, it's because it literally comes from a radio program, but there was a burst of a pipeline carrying diesel in the southern part of the state in New Carmel, Illinois, a diesel spill into rivers. So on this end, it's something quite ubiquitous, and I certainly wish this wasn't the kind of correspondence that that we would have to discuss today, but perhaps our thoughts and efforts today can be an effort towards not having to announce more oil spills. And so we can, in approaching today's topic, consider how oil, which constitutes so much of our lives, including food, cosmetics, clothing, and all the many forms of stuff that plastic takes, turns out to be so difficult to see. As we heard from last month's speaker in the series, Imre Zeman, part of this has to do with the underground pipelines that convey oil across vast distances while remaining safely out of sight. But it's also hard to view something that undergoes so many transformations. It looks this way with oil. In North America, we experience power, electricity, motion, and contend with their materiality through monthly bills, home meters, and gas pumps. We bear witness to the damage of domestic refineries about as much as we do the underserved, contaminated neighborhoods that surround them. That is, when the oil spills or the multiple pressures of the neighborhoods cause residents to protest. So if we glimpse the above-ground infrastructure of oil only when it rolls through our news feed as one more global crisis, then its subterranean dimension lies quite safely buried. In the name of exposure, let me say at the outset, and I might not have to this crowd, but the American Midwest runs on the sticky bitumen known as Canadian oil, or tar sands, that reaches us through pipelines that cross vital freshwater ways. Refined in cities like Whiting, Indiana, Detroit, and Sarnia, Ontario, local residents have begun to see the system at work through a byproduct, petroleum coke, stored in the open air in neighborhoods. The 2010 burst of the Line 6B pipeline that released 1 million gallons of this bitumen into the Kalamazoo River, a tributary of Lake Michigan, also motivated people to look for where oil crosses their water. It seems to me that the challenge ahead is to see our form of extreme energy as part of a system in which extraction wreaks havoc on the First Nations whose sovereign lands are near the oil sands, contingent labor that never quite provides the jobs promised as the trade-off for environmental risk, rural communities that stand to lose the benefits of the country, and urban communities, in large part communities of color, that are exposed to petrochemicals on a daily basis. Such communities, with long histories of union involvement, seem to be punished further as investors seek location with cheaper labor and even fewer regulations. From any of these viewpoints, the allure of oil begins to fade. As interested as I am in exploring the idea that protecting our common water from oil can bring all of these communities together with everyone who drinks water, I am all the more eager to hear from our three panelists today. Without hyperbole, I am thrilled to welcome the very people whose vision for the future of Great Lakes cities may just set us on the right course. So I'll introduce the panelists, and then I'll defer to them and to speak in the order of introduction, if that's okay with all of you. Professor Noah Hall is on the faculty of Wayne State University Law School and serves as a scholarship director for the Great Lakes Environmental Law Center. His teaching and expertise is in environmental and water law, and his research focuses on public and private water rights, transboundary water management and pollution, climate change adaptation, U.S.-Canadian environmental law, and citizen enforcement. Professor Hall is a co-author of a new casebook on water law called Modern Water Law, Private Property, Public Rights, and Environmental Protections, as well as a dozen articles published in leading journals. Before joining the Wayne State University Law School faculty, Professor Hall taught at the University of Michigan Law School and was an attorney with the National Wildlife Federation, where he managed the Great Lakes Water Resources Program. In 2016, Professor Hall was appointed Special Assistant Attorney General for Michigan, joining the special counsel team for the Flint water investigation. Thomas Frank is an artist and activist who has been working for environmental justice in the Calumet region for the past decade. He is committed to addressing heavily contaminated industrial lands and bringing them back into use for community-focused development and a just transition to a low-carbon economy. He is a member of the Southeast Coalition to Ban Petcoke and has served as the executive director of the Indiana Harbor Shipping Canal with the task of cleaning up one of the most polluted bodies of water in the United States. Thomas served as a board member for the Wolf Lake Initiative, a bi-state environmental organization committed to promoting the use, preservation, and protection of Wolf Lake's natural resources. Dr. Cecilia Martinez is the co-founder and director of research programs at the Center for Earth, Energy, and Democracy in Minneapolis. Dr. Martinez previously held positions as associate research professor in the College of Earth, Ocean, and Environment at the University of Delaware, associate professor at the Metropolitan State University, and research director at the American Indian Policy Center. She has led a variety of projects to address sustainable development at the local and international levels. Her research is focused on the development of energy and environmental strategies that promote equitable and sustainable policies. Dr. Martinez has also worked with a range of organizations from local grassroots groups to international organizations engaging in the promotion of sound environmental policy and environmental justice. She served on the Climate Action Planning Steering Committee for the City of Minneapolis and has been appointed to several national advisory boards. She is also on the leadership team for the National EJ and Science Initiative and is leading the effort on a Truth and Reconciliation Commission on Environmental Harms. Most recently, she co-authored a chapter on environmental justice and climate resiliency with Dr. Nikki Sheets. She is working on a manuscript on environmental justice and climate change, and among her publications is a co-edited volume, Environmental Justice, Discourses in International Political Economy, which includes some of her work on North American indigenous peoples and the challenge of forging a common agenda of indigenous rights, justice, and sustainability. Join me in welcoming our three panelists to take us through and hopefully after the refined state.
Great, thank you guys. Thanks everyone for coming out today. Thanks to the Freshwater Lab and the Institute for Humanities here at UIC for organizing this and inviting me. Thanks to Linda Vavra for really doing all the work to make the visit easy and possible, and especially to Rachel for, just really all of her insights and her dialogue and for inviting me to be a part of this and bringing this all together. It's fantastic. I'm going to talk about, my perspective on oil in the Great Lakes region from a little bit of a tale of three components. I'll tell you where I'm going and then how I hope to get there. I think in the Great Lakes region we have a complex, inconsistent, at times hypocritical approach towards oil. And this is shown in really the three stages of oil development and use. First of all, oil drilling, second, oil pipelines, and then third, oil refining. And what I guess I'd like to share with you is our law and our policy approach to each one of those three steps, how we treat oil drilling, how we treat piping oil and oil transportation in the Great Lakes, and ultimately then how we treat oil refining in the Great Lakes region. And what I hope to show is that we take very different approaches to those three different stages, not for any reasons of good energy policy or planning or foresight, but rather because it shows, frankly, some of the ongoing and systematic problems we have with injustice and racism in environmental law and policy, and how those play out with oil in the Great Lakes region. So let's start with, and the story's gonna go basically in order of good to bad. So I guess we're gonna end on a bad note. I'll start with the good. The good is oil drilling, and then it gets into kind of the medium. The medium is the oil transportation and oil piping. And then last is the refining, which is really the bad news. So let's start with the oil drilling. It's actually kind of nice. My guess is that most folks in this audience aren't even really aware that drilling for oil in the Great Lakes region is an issue, because it's been addressed now for about 10 years, which in the scheme of environmental policy kind of makes it a distant issue. But the Great Lakes actually hold a tremendous amount of oil and gas. I got the numbers, not that they'll probably mean much to anybody, but 300 million barrels of oil under the Great Lakes in the U.S. side alone. There's about another 100 million on the Canadian side. 5 trillion cubic feet of natural gas reserves. Most of the oil is in Lake Michigan and Lake Huron, and would be under the jurisdiction of the state of Michigan. What's that? Yeah, most of the gas is under Lake Erie, shared in jurisdiction by the states of Michigan and Ohio. And just so folks know, the way Great Lakes work and the bottomlands underneath the Great Lakes, the bottomlands underneath the Great Lakes are the jurisdiction of the individual states. So if I had been prepared with a map, you would see a patchwork of different state boundaries carving up the bottomlands of the Great Lakes. And we've had oil and gas drilling in the Great Lakes for over a century. Actually, some of the first oil drilling and gas drilling, when that technology was becoming available and used, was off of Ohio and Lake Erie. And starting in the 1980s, especially after some of the oil spills off the California coast, there was increasing public scrutiny and pressure and concern about oil and gas drilling in the Great Lakes. And in 1985, all eight of the U.S. Great Lakes states. Their governors signed a handshake agreement saying that they would prohibit oil and gas drilling in the Great Lakes. This was just a handshake agreement. It wasn't binding. Some states took really strong protective measures. Michigan, for example, banned new oil and gas drilling. Ohio took some measures. Typically, though, they focused on banning new, not shutting down existing oil and gas drilling. There was opposition to what was called slant drilling, which is where you use an onshore drilling facility and you, like the name implies, you put the well on a slant and it gets under the Great Lakes bottomlands like that. And so this patchwork of inconsistent state laws was in place for about 16 years until 2001. The U.S. Congress stepped in, and even though the Great Lakes bottomlands are the jurisdiction of the individual states, the federal government has the constitutional authority to step in and essentially supersede the power of the states. And this is what happened in 2001. Congress enacted a two-year ban on new oil drilling in the Great Lakes. They renewed that two-year ban in 2003 and then again in 2005. And while those two-year, maybe moratorium is a better word than ban, while those two-year moratoriums were in place, Congress also directed the Army Corps of Engineers to do a study of the risks of oil drilling in the Great Lakes. This is all really kind of methodical, like kind of good policy. You know, the public becomes concerned about an issue, the states take some action, the state action is decent but maybe not very consistent, doesn't go far enough. The federal government steps in with moratoriums at first to give time to study the problem, continues the moratoriums while the studies continue, and then ultimately in 2005, in a provision just called Section 386 of the 2005 Energy Policy Act, the federal government finally banned oil and gas drilling in the Great Lakes. And actually, this was done with tremendous bipartisan support. One of the leading proponents of the ban on oil and gas drilling was one of Michigan's representatives, Fred Upton, who's not known for being a friend of the environment and certainly not a friend of environmental regulation. He later became chair of the relevant House committee that is supposed to be enacting new environmental laws, and under his watch did not. But he was a strong opponent of oil and gas drilling. He actually had some really nice testimony talking about how, despite the signs saying it's safe, he wants to go with the precautionary principle and really concerned. So this is the good news. And so now oil and gas drilling, this is why I'm guessing most of this room is kind of bored right now and thinking, like, why even talking about oil and gas drilling? It's been a non-issue for 10 years. We took care of it. It's one of those rare success stories of the past few decades in environmental law. There was a problem, there was public concern, there was government action, and it was solved. And it was solved bipartisan with support from folks who you don't always think of as green. We'll come back to that and look at sort of how remarkable or maybe how explainable that is in contrast to our mixed take on oil transportation with pipelines and our really weak approach to oil refining. So then pipelines. All right, so we've now banned oil and gas drilling in the Great Lakes, but of course we haven't banned oil and gas transportation through the Great Lakes. As Rachel was explaining, a large part of our current oil dependency system, our oil addiction, is delivered through tar sands oil from Western Canada, coming through a series of North American pipelines that basically take one of two routes through the Midwest. Either the pipelines cut over northern Michigan and down the Straits of Mackinac, the infamous Line 5 that goes through the Straits of Mackinac, connecting the Upper Peninsula and Lower Peninsula, going through the Great Lakes, then down through Michigan and out to Sarnia, Ontario. And then a second route that cuts, basically follows I-94, more or less, I'm not going to bother with maps, it's good enough. Basically follows I-94 from Minnesota to southeast Michigan. You know, just cuts right across, the same way you would drive. All right, these pipelines are a problem, obviously. The pipelines are by and large old. on the order of 50 to 60 years old is when most of them were constructed. And it's at about that age that infrastructure typically fails. Furthermore, these pipelines were designed to carry conventional crude, not the diluted bitumen, the dilbit, that's the product derived, that's basically tar sands oil diluted so you can move it through a pipeline. And as both engineers and environmental advocates expected and warned, not only do they burst regularly and fail regularly, but sometimes those bursts and failures are disastrous in every sense of the word. And this is exactly what happened in 2010, July 25th, 2010. The Enbridge Line 6, which is the one that parallels I-94. Enbridge is the company that runs this large North American pipeline system. Line 6, which cuts through southern Michigan, burst right along a seam, a welding seam, which is where engineers would expect these failures to happen, burst, and over the course of about 18 hours, which I'll double back to that in a moment, over the course of about 18 hours, as Rachel said, close to 1 million gallons of diluted dilbit was released into a wetland, which is where the pipeline was located. Most of you know where wetlands go. They flow to the nearest, the water in wetlands flows out to the nearest creek, in this case, Talmadge Creek, which flows out to the nearest river, in this case, the Kalamazoo River. And we had, as a result, beginning in July 25th, but then really pathetically, disastrously, and I can't use strong enough language for it, continuing until July 26th, this pipeline continued to gush, resulting in the biggest oil release, oil spill in this region's history. And the reaction to the it's usually called the Kalamazoo River oil spill. I think the reaction to it I would characterize as sort of like there's a good and a bad to it. On the plus side, we became far more concerned with the oil pipelines in our region. All of a sudden, we want to know where are the pipelines, how old are they, what risks do they pose. A tremendous amount of attention has been put on the Line 5 pipeline in the Mackinac Straits, the one that would essentially release oil into Lakes Huron and Lake Michigan. And so there's a lot of focus on the oil pipelines. But again, and this is, I think, one of the themes you'll probably hear from a lot of us, not as much focus on where that oil is going, ultimately where it's being refined, and even less focus and attention on this underlying oil addiction that fuels the whole system or drives the whole system. So much like I think we saw after the BP oil spill in the Gulf, you know, on the one hand, we kind of freak out about the oil spill, right? You know, like we have to ban oil drilling in this location or we can't have these pipelines. But very rarely does it cause us to step back and say, we might have a problem. You know, like an addict that kind of goes to further and further steps, more, you know, takes more and more desperate measures, riskier and riskier behavior to keep obtaining and using. You know, we kind of come down hard on the behavior, but never step back and say, what's going on with us that we're making these choices, that we're taking these risks, that we're causing this harm? Legally, the Enbridge oil spill case has actually been somewhat of a success. Enbridge has been held fully responsible. They've incurred over $1 billion in liability, mostly paid to the state, huge fines, things like that. But I think I want to just take another few moments to really talk about what happened with this pipeline, because I think it's going to show that the story is even worse than it sounds. This was not a simple accident. And this was not like, oh, pipelines burst from time to time, but luckily we have Enbridge there to run the pipeline and take all necessary measures. This was a small accident that became a huge disaster because of systematic failures by the company located thousands of miles from the region in which they were doing business, and by a regulatory system that is just not equipped legally or politically to take on this problem on the public's behalf. So first of all, Enbridge is based out of Western Canada. The Enbridge Control Room is in Edmonton. And when this pipeline burst in July 25th, 2010, they got their warning signals in the pipeline control room. You know, it's very high tech, right? Because technology is a solution to everything. Very high tech, and you know, warning signs go off. You got a burst pipeline in this place called Michigan. So what you're supposed to do is shut the pipeline down. They didn't. When asked about it later, they said, oh yeah, we get those warning signs. We just don't worry about them. We actually just restart it. So they restarted it. The initial pipelines, I wanted to make this point, actually, Rachel said it was close to 1 million gallons. That's correct, but that's kind of ignoring a few little details in here. The initial pipeline rupture only released a little over 100,000 gallons before that stream of dilbit had all been released and done. And then a second shift came on duty in the Edmonton Control Center for Enbridge. The second shift restarted the pipeline again. Sure, there were warning signs saying you've lost pressure, the lights are flashing, you know, pipeline burst. Don't worry about it. They just cranked it right back up and sent another few 100,000 gallons through the pipeline, which of course were released into Talmadge Creek and ultimately into the Kalamazoo River. And then a third shift came on, and the third shift again restarts the pipeline, sends another few 100,000 gallons of oil out, all pouring out into Talmadge Creek. During this time, during the 18 hours that this pipeline was ruptured and gushing oil, there were literally hundreds of resident calls, things like, I smell oil, it smells bad here, I think there's a problem, people calling 911, their local fire and emergency responders. None of this is reaching Edmonton. So this is maybe just a small theme and really not the focus, but it shows one of the inherent risks of having dangerous polluting infrastructure maintained and controlled in really distant locations from where the harm occurs and where people are affected, right? This is not your local company. So Edmonton, none of this is reaching them. Ironically, actually, the way that the pipeline was finally shut down, the local utility in that part of Michigan is called Consumers Energy. Not many people would think of them as a friend of the environment either. I've personally sued them several times over coal-fired power plants and dams that kill fish. I literally have a line of cases of, you know, public interest group, whatever, v. Consumers Energy. So it kind of pains me to give them credit. But Consumers Energy was getting a lot of these calls like, we smell gas, because you call your gas company. And it was finally somebody on the ground from Consumers Energy, which is headquartered less than an hour away from where the spill occurred, who somehow managed to dial up Enbridge and Edmonton and say, you know, idiots, your pipeline is ruptured, shut it down. And so I guess it says something about how bad the company is that it took Consumers Energy to help them get their act together. So finally they shut this down, all right? And what we learned subsequent to this is that this is typical. Pipelines all across the region are aged. The regulations for their safety and their quality are not up to the task of the risk they pose. There's supposed to be all kinds of monitoring and testing. I mean, if you talk to the engineers, they've got all these, you know, all these things, that, these gizmos they have that are supposed to make it safe. They call it a pig. They run some pig through the pipeline. It's some kind of robot that, it's not a real pig. It's like a robot that goes through the pipeline and like finds out if there's holes. And actually the technology sort of works. It's that nobody listens to it. So the pig runs through and finds weaknesses in the welding, and that just gets put into a report and shoved to the back of the room. All right, so... But the reason I'm putting the pipelines in the middle of the story is I'm actually fairly optimistic that the end of the story on pipelines will be a good one. I guess I'm optimistic. I think that we're going to shut down the Enbridge Line 5 going through the Straits for much the same reason that I think oil drilling in the Great Lakes was banned, which again, I'm putting that off for a few moments, but it's going to be contrasted with the oil refining situation. But, I won't put it off. I'll just jump right into it. Because basically, the impact of both, or the potential impact of oil drilling, keep in mind we never really even had much in the way of bad oil disasters in the Great Lakes. We've had a few relatively smaller spills, but nothing on the order of the harm that's resulted from refining. But the oil drilling and the potential risk of a rupture in the Line 5 pipeline in the Straits of Mackinac affects everybody. And actually, it doesn't just affect everybody equally. It tends to affect wealthier, more politically powerful, whiter constituents disproportionately. The people, think about this for a moment. If there's an oil spill in Northern Lake Michigan or Northern Lake Huron, who's going to be affected by that? Communities like Traverse City, Michigan, Petoskey, Michigan, Door County, Wisconsin, places that, I guess to be blunt, wealthy white people own property. We don't tolerate oil spills in those places. Fred Upton takes a really strong environmental stance against environmental risks of pollution to those kinds of places. If oil pollution is going to affect the Lake Michigan shoreline, that's not acceptable. And the studies that are showing the result of a pipeline rupture in the Straits and what it would do to the Great Lakes shoreline, in northern Michigan, and I don't want to just pick on Michigan, in the Georgian Bay, which is, again, a very wealthy, high-end, privileged place to own waterfront property, I think is the reason why I'm optimistic that eventually these things are going to get shut down. Those folks know how to make phone calls that get answered and result in new environmental laws. So now I don't want to take much more time. Now let's contrast that with oil refinery. I don't know. I don't even want to beat around this anymore. Let's just get right into it. So if oil drilling and to a lesser extent oil piping, and the reason I say to a lesser extent, there are plenty of oil pipelines that run underground in parts of the region that people don't care about, that are poor and off the map and rural, and we don't care about those as much. But oil drilling and oil piping through the Great Lakes, if those affect advantage populations, oil refining disproportionately affects disadvantaged populations. So what do you think our law and policy response is to that? It's pretty logical. I know you guys have a big issue here with the BP refinery. I've mostly focused on the Marathon refining operation in Detroit. I'm going to talk about that for just a moment or two before I turn it over, although I suspect most of what I say about the Marathon plant is going to be the same story with BP. Marathon. Marathon Oil Refining is located in southwest Detroit, in a zip code 48217, southwest Detroit, which is the most polluted, toxic, environmentally dangerous zip code in Michigan. There's no other way to put it. I would not want to raise my family there. Fortunately, I have the economic means to not raise my family there. Most of the population who is in 48217 is there because they don't have the economic means to be anywhere else. So they get to live next to the Marathon oil refining operation. It was bad enough living next to the Marathon refinery 10 or 15 years ago. Now it's getting worse. Marathon has spent $2 billion to expand their refinery in southwest Detroit. This is in the city limits, in the 48217 zip code. They spent $2 billion to upgrade and expand their refinery to be able to handle the tar sands dilbit, which is where the money is these days, refining dilbit. They didn't have to come up with that $2 billion on their own. The city of Detroit helped them out with close to $200 million in tax breaks. Apparently, City of Detroit's got a lot of money to give away in tax breaks. State of Michigan gave them plenty of tax breaks as well. So that it's very fair to say that the Marathon Oil refining operation is not only allowed and under-regulated, but is subsidized. There's not much we can do about it. I'm a lawyer by background. In addition to Great Lakes work, I do a lot of work on environmental justice. Doing legal work on environmental justice is frustrating and all but impossible. There's a Supreme Court decision from about, I don't know now what it is, like 10, 12 years old, which, as you probably know, we, to some extent, outlaw discrimination in this country, right? I can't not allow you to come to this talk because you're black. Everybody knows that inherently as part of our civil rights. However, if we offer this talk in a time or a location or a venue that disproportionately makes it hard to get to if you're black, that's not against the law. And this is the U.S. Supreme Court case in a nutshell. It's called, you guys aren't going to write this down, but it's called Alexander versus Sandoval. And what it says is that the Civil Rights Act, the Supreme Court narrowly interpreted the Civil Rights Act to prohibit intentional discrimination. And on the other hand, the Civil Rights Act is interpreted to not prohibit what we call disparate impact, which is a fancy term for saying discrimination that just happens. What this means is that environmental racism, environmental justice, is in effect legalized. While Marathon cannot intentionally pollute, 48217, I should have mentioned this, but you could have guessed it, it's not white, right? I mean, you probably figure that part out. 48217 is not white. Marathon can't intentionally source pollution near communities of color. But if the result of their actions is that a community of color is disproportionately poisoned, that's lawful. There's no problem there. So that's exactly what's happened. I'm going to wrap this up with just like a few little points here, actually. So the oil refining occurs in the communities, of course, that are most disadvantaged. And so we do very little to regulate the air emissions, the water pollution, the resulting waste products. We subsidize them. We give them permits for expansion, things like that. Marathon's approach to appeasing the concerns of the community on first glance looked generous, and then you peel them back and it shows really the bigger problem. Marathon magnanimously offered to buy out all the affected properties. Okay, so if you happen to be one of these families, one of the hundreds of families that lives near Marathon, your children are being poisoned, don't worry, Marathon's gonna buy your property. Turns out the average value of homes, there were about 250 homes at issue here. Average market value of the homes, $16,000. I mean, think about that, especially folks who live in Chicago. I don't know how far $16,000 gets you for housing in Chicago. But if your home is worth $16,000, I think that tells you a lot more than any of the other facts and figures about the communities that are affected. And Marathon was very generous. They even offered to pay more than fair market value. So, you would get $25,000 or $30,000 for your home. Of course, your home is only worth $16,000 because it's located in the middle of the most polluted zip code in the state, which Marathon has quite a bit to do with. And then here's the final thing, the pet coke piles. I'll turn it over with this. For those who don't know, pet coke is a convenient byproduct of refining oil, dilbit. It produces this product called petroleum coke. Luckily in the US, we're not allowed to burn this stuff because it's dirtier than coal, but it's a wonderful product to export to Mexico, Japan, other parts of Asia. The Koch brothers, this is the pet coke piles that were on the Detroit River. This is what Marathon Oil produces. Those are owned by the Koch brothers. I don't know. What does there even say about pet coke? It sells for about two-thirds. It's like coal's dirtier cousin. which is a scary thought that Cole has a dirtier cousin. It's like you thought Cole was bad enough, wait till you meet its cousin. Cole's dirtier cousin, it sells for about 2/3 the price of Cole. It's like the poor man's Cole. And we produce this stuff out of Dilbit. We export it. And again, the only time we care about it is when it piles up. The only reason this got any attention in Detroit, that behind there, that building is the Michigan Central Railroad building, an abandoned building in Detroit. We have piles of shit like this all over Detroit. Nobody cares. The only reason the Petco piles got any attention was because they started getting so big and in so many locations that the little bits of gentrification we have in Detroit, where people actually spend more than $16,000 for a home, we're beginning to notice them. And so the city had to, they didn't shut them down, they just had to move them away from places where people who can call their city councilmen would see them. And that's what we've done with them. But this is, it's out of sight, but by no means out of mind. Mm-hmm. We're still producing this stuff and exporting it, and I won't even get into the climate change implications. Actually, I think I've probably said way too much. Why don't I turn it over? Thank you, guys.
I'm Thomas Frank.
I live in East Chicago, Indiana. I kind of married into the community about 20 years ago. I'm from the north side. The south side to me was a kind of a black hole to my consciousness. There were islands on the south side, Hyde Park, the Science Museum and stuff. But East Chicago, I didn't ever heard of that. Southeast side of Chicago, is that in Lake Michigan? I didn't really know much about that. It wasn't really until I was introduced to the area, the region with my wife. So what I've been doing in the last 20 years is giving these tours. Once I've learned and became more and more involved, I started trying to bring awareness to what's happening here on the north side. What Noah just explained and did, he did an amazing job of explaining two things. What Enbridge has done with the spill in the Kalamazoo, and also touching on EJ issues. East Chicago is predominantly Latino. It's about 60% Latino and about 35% African American. I'm a white elite. I have a lot of privilege. I'm from the professional classes. I'm from the north side. I'm not characteristic of my community. So that's something to be aware of right away. So where East Chicago is located is on the southern shores of Lake Michigan. What's significant about that is on the Illinois side in the Chicago metropolitan area, you have a population of 7.1 million people. That's more than the population of the entire state of Indiana, which is only about 6.7 million. So there's between Indianapolis and Chicago, there's the push and pull and fight politically over the resources. And in fact, we're kind of colonized by Chicago. We serve the Chicago market. We sit on the Great Lakes, as we already know, is the largest freshwater resource in the world. I used to be the director of the Indian Harbor Shipping Canal, which I'm going to show you a little bit later. On the southern shores of Lake Michigan, because of the way the glacial retreat occurred, that region of the United States, or this continent, is the fourth most biodiverse region in the entire continent, North America. It shares in the flora and fauna in the northeast, northwest, southeast, and southwest. It's an amazing biodiverse region. It grows very, very fast. But what we've done to the north southern shores of Lake Michigan, which is about 45 miles from Illinois to Michigan, is 2/3 of it we've industrialized. And in fact, in the 1950s, we were going to industrialize the entire lakefront in Indiana, where the dunes are. It took a congressman from Illinois, because we really don't have the political power in northwest Indiana, but it took Congressman Douglas to save the dunes. If you heard the Save the Dunes campaign. So we now have a national, federal park over in on the east side. And as a compromise, we expanded over to Ogden Dunes and Portage area. And to this day, they flattened those dunes. The entire southern shores of Lake Michigan are dunes and swale, but you don't really see it on the western edge in East Chicago, Hammond, Whiting, and Gary, because we've really flattened out those dunes. What we did when we expanded in the 50s to Portage is we took those dunes and we sent them up to Northwestern, and we expanded Northwestern into Lake Michigan on Indiana Dune sand. So to give you a little bit of history, we are on the southern shores of Lake Michigan. We are really industrial fiefdoms from the 19th century, and that's how we were set up. Whiting was founded by Standard Oil in 1889. East Chicago was founded in 1893, the same year as the World Fair, by Inland Steel. And for about almost 100 years, those cities operated in a paternal relationship with those industries. They took care of those industries, or those communities. It wasn't until the 70s when capital started to escape the region and globalize that we started to see a decoupling of our community's fortunes from the company's fortunes. So, give you an example. In East Chicago in 1970, East Chicago employed about 70,000 people in steel and steel-related jobs. Today, East Chicago employs less than 2,500. But steel production, not exponentially, but linearly, has grown. Production has grown year after year. We just saw a blip in 2008 when we had the recession. We consider ourselves the workshop of America. That's the mythology that we built up. Smoke represents jobs. That's how we view it in Northwest Indiana. All right, so when we started to deindustrialize the Great Lakes region in the 1970s, the EPA recognized 43 areas of concern on the Great Lakes, and East Chicago was identified as one. And in fact, East Chicago was identified as the most impaired. The way in which we measure that is based on 14 beneficial uses. East Chicago, and this is the Indian River Shipping Canal, which leads into the Grand Calumet River, fails every one of those beneficial uses. As you can see, it's been highly industrialized. So the Indian River Shipping Canal consists of 90% of wastewater from industry and sewage. There are 150 leaking petroleum underground storage tanks on its shores. There are 15 combined sewer overflows that represent 12 billion gallons of raw wastewater that goes into Lake Michigan, and I can just go on and on. This is the Indian River Shipping Canal in 1969, before the Clean Water Act was enacted. 1970, the oil industry, at that time Standard Oil used to filter its systems in the Grand Cal. This is today on my toxic tours. It's not unusual when we see dead fish. All right, so the context in this happens, and why does this happen, is you look at our environmental stewardship in Indiana. Why are these heavy industries still thriving in Northwest Indiana on the shores of Lake Michigan, but not in Illinois? Well, when it comes to industrial discharges in its waterway, Indiana discharges 33% more industrial toxins into its waterways, regulated toxins, than any other state in the union. In fact, you can take the last 26 states, which represent over 100 million people, and still Indiana discharges more than that, and they only represent 6.7 million. You have Indiana compared to Illinois. Indiana discharges about three times more. The beach in East Chicago is considered the third most polluted beach in the United States, the most polluted beach in the Great Lakes. All right, so when it comes to the air, in terms of toxic release inventories, there are 3,140 counties in the United States. Almost every single county is 600 square miles. Lake County, Indiana regularly ranks in the top 10 in terms of industrial toxins into the airshed. And that's entirely attributed to BP, ArcelorMittal, and U.S. Steel. In 2008, BP was recognized as the fourth largest source of industrial pollutants to Chicago's airshed because of the northeasterlies that goes out into Lake Michigan and it brings it back over to the city. So here's BP. To give you an understanding of what BP is, it has a footprint of 1,400 acres, similar to the same footprint of the Loop in downtown Chicago. You can see it's on the shores of Lake Michigan. In 2007, BP did like what the Marathon plant did in Detroit. They decided to retool the refinery and to go onto heavy sour crude from Canada, And with their water permit, the NPDES permit, they decided to put, if you understand permitting, basically what permitting works is you scribble something on a piece of paper and you submit it. It doesn't matter if it's very detailed or even fulfills the requirements of the permit. It's up to the community to then find it and fish it out. Mm-hmm. From that point on, then you can hire on a bunch of lawyers. Tax deductible, don't have to pay for a lot. But anyhow, their discharges into Lake Michigan in that permit with an increase of ammonia by 54% and sludge of 35%. Clear violation of the Clean Water Act. It wasn't until Michael Hawthorne of the Tribune put that on the front pages that this permit had already been issued. Indiana had already given them this, that it suddenly created an outrage. When it comes to the air permit, in 2008, BP was awarded an air permit with increased particulate matter by 21%, sulfur dioxide by 20%, lead by 25%, and carbon dioxide by about 2 million tons a year. What I didn't tell you is they are also exempt in terms of the water permit from mercury discharges. For the last 7 years, they've been completely exempt. I think they discharge 7 times the allowable limit. And then there comes to land. BP in 19, at the time it was named Amoco. BP had bought Amoco. In 1991, they were responsible for a 16.8 million gallon spill onto our water table in East Chicago, Whiting, and Hammond. The residents in Hammond, it's called, a neighborhood called Robertsdale, they actually saw the oil bubbling up into their basements. They sued them and actually lost the suit because they couldn't prove it was their oil. So to this day, they've never been cited, never been charged, and it's never been cleaned up. So for the last 25 years, floating on our water table, right on the shores of Lake Michigan, is 16.8 million gallons. The reason why is that they really couldn't identify it as BP's or Amoco's at that time is because of the historic contamination. The amount of accumulated releases that there were into the water table over the years. So here's a little description of their retooling of the refinery. It was about about $4.5 billion investment. They built, at the time, the largest distillation tower. It's really like a space rocket. The second largest coking unit, that's kind of a second dairy refining process that produces pet coke as a residue. Petroleum coke is a byproduct. And that produced about 2.2 million tons of that a year. Now with this refining, as I told you, Whiting was traditionally known as BP Whiting Refinery or Standard Oil Whiting. In Chicago was traditionally known as a steel town. With this project, what they did is they actually moved the refinery out of Whiting and moved it into East Chicago. So where the refining part capacity is in East Chicago. In fact, they moved that across the street from our National Historic District. It's called Marktown. And it'll parallel some of the stories you've heard in Detroit. East Chicago awarded BP $165 million to produce this in East Chicago. East Chicago is one of the poorest cities in the state of Indiana. And so I'm going to skip the byproduct of petroleum coke. What we're beginning to see are piling up on the Calumet River in the southeast side of Chicago. So they're producing 2.2 million tons of that, which has been producing just like what you've heard in Detroit, piling up. In fact, it was being piling up by two companies, Beamster Bohr and the Koch brothers. Beamster Bohr had no permit for that. So we were able to shut them down almost immediately. The Koch brothers had two facilities that they were operating. We were able to get one of them shut down. You can see how close these piles are to the neighborhood. What really created the uproar was when the wind started blowing and the coke was blowing all over. We thought there was fire somewhere or something like that. And that's really what stirred up the actions. So the coalition to ban petcoke, the Southeast Coalition to ban petcokes, started up to fight this campaign. All right, so I'm coming back to Marktown. So here's the refinery up here in the top right that they moved into East Chicago, across the street from Marktown. Marktown is a historic, if you remember in the earlier days of industrialization, we created these utopian villages, worker villages. You have Pullman in Chicago. We have Marktown in East Chicago. You have Thomas Edison homes in Gary. And there's various others, utopian villages. This was designed in 1917 by Howard Van Doren Shaw. It's based on a Garden City concept, Ebenezer Howard's concept of walkable communities. It looks like an English Tudor village. And just like Detroit, what we've seen in the last 50 years is the encroachment of industry moving and in actually surrounding Marktown. And that became really evident with the new refinery moving right across the street. It then closed it off. There were rumors when BP announced its project that BP was intending to tear down Marktown when they moved across the street. So the citizens of Marktown sent BP a letter asking if this was the case. The head of BP sent the letter back saying, no, we have no intentions of tearing down Marktown. And then in 2014, a month after they finished their project, they then started buying up properties in Marktown and sending out demolition notices. No. Now, just like Marathon, the neighborhood there, in our fence line communities, the average home value in those neighborhoods is about $14,000 to maybe a top $25,000. So to recognize the difference in terms of a lot of these people, a lot of these people were boosters for industries. They believed in industries. They weren't fighting industry. So when these demolition notices came out, the first thing they thought was, who betrayed us? You know, they've been protecting the industry. They haven't been sharing their cancers or their stories or their problems. They believed in those industries. But the moment they started coming down, that changed everything. And we started a campaign to save Marktown. You can see the coking unit right across down the street. But that wasn't able to stop, you know, one of the most profitable industries in human history from tearing down a very poor, low-income workers' village. So today, about 20% of Marktown has been torn down. It's on the National Register of Historic Places, but because we don't have an ordinance to protect it locally, we can't fight it. So as they were starting up the refinery after building it, they've had lots of malfunctions, major flare-ups. There's two ways in which with the major malfunction, if there's a blast or a malfunction, there's two exhaust systems. One's out to the lake or one's up the stack. And so regularly you started seeing these major flares. And then, of course, they had a commingling of the product in the cooling unit. And so in March of 2014, they spilled into Lake Michigan about 1,600 pounds or 1,600 gallons, as they report. Now, this is a self-reporting situation. They unannounced for almost a full day before they announced it to the public that something had gone wrong. So when we came on site, they had already done their cleanup. You know, everything had been cleaned up somewhat. Again, while the strikers last year, they had a strike at the facility due to safety issues. While that was occurring, there were major flare-ups. They struck for about 6 months. You rarely ever see oil spills. This is on Indianapolis Boulevard. But during that time, there was an oil spill. When the strike was on, we heard stories from the workforce that there were about 4 to 5 oil spills a day in the facility. All right, so we'll go give you a little bit about Enbridge. How many of you heard about Keystone? Everybody heard, most of you have heard of, how many of you before tonight have ever heard about Enbridge? Oh, so this is very good. So while everybody's been focusing on this phantom pipeline, Sierra Club said they can go out and do civil disobedience against a phantom pipeline. Enbridge has been building out a network through our region 4 times larger, where the Keystone represent about 900,000 barrels a day, which wasn't built. Enbridge built out 2.5 million barrels a day of a network going through this region. which resulted in the Kalamazoo River spill in 2010. We also, if you see these placards, you know, they're trying to put as much, they can't build enough capacity pipelines, so they're putting it on rail, so we're seeing what we're calling bomb trains. They've been exploding. This is in Lac Mégantic, Quebec in 2013, where 47 people died because it blew up in the city center. This was just last year in Galena on the Mississippi, and there's been several others between this time. They're also have been thinking about creating what we know the Great Lakes is Highway H2O, looking to convert it to Highway H2 oil, looking to come to the Indian Harbor Shipping Canal where BP is, to bring it down from Superior, Wisconsin down here. We fought that, we've been winning so far, especially up in Superior, to stop them from building the docks. But BP is continuing to build their docks. They're building international shipping barge traffics on the Indian Harbor Shipping Canal. So I told you about the strike. For about 6 months, the workforce was on strike through some of the coldest winters. I was on the picket line with them almost every day. So while we've been in the late stages of the fossil fuel era, and we've recommitted, and we didn't just, you know, late stages, some of the damage you do is even magnified. And we're becoming more dependent on the tar sands, which are the dirtiest form of oil there is. It's also occurring in the northern Alberta, where the Great Boreal Forest is. So two things about that. It's the largest engineering project in human history, which is occurring up in northern Alberta, much of it on native properties, unceded native properties. And the other thing is it's happening in the boreal forest, which is the largest carbon sink on the planet. The problem is this is also the largest deforestation project on the planet. But anyhow, we built out a lot of resistance movement. This is up in British Columbia, the Unetosten camp. They've basically built infrastructure on the pathway of pipelines on their land and dare the industry to come in and lay pipeline, which is what Bow, Nebraska did as well with the Keystone. They built alternative energy along the pipeline. You have Tim to Christopher, which came at the end of the Bush administration, who bought up leases, oil leases. He served 2 years in prison. He started a group called Peaceful Uprising. You have the Southeast Side, which has been fighting the petcoke piles. You have James Hansen, who is the leading climatologist for NASA Goddard Institute, who's now putting himself on the line to get arrested. You have the MICAS, the Michigan Coalition Against Tar Sands, when they were laying down the 6B pipeline. What Enbridge did when they spilled into the Kalamazoo River, what they didn't tell people is they deferred maintenance on that for 10 years. And then when the spill occurred, they used that as an excuse to double the size of the 6B. So Chris Womoff took a skateboard and went into the pipeline and stopped construction for a day. You have several other women called the MICAT 3, which locked down in Michigan and stopped construction. And then we got 400,000 people 2 years ago, last September, in New York. This is interesting because we can get 400,000 people to march against 350 parts per million, but we can't get 400,000 people to march against, you know, environmental justice issues in communities of color. What we need to do is introduce EJ issues and values to the climate justice movement. We need to have those two campaigns married. So last year we bought, I don't know if you know, Reverend Billy in the Stop Shop Shopping Choir. We brought him down to BP. And he performed an exorcism on BP. That was very nice. And then last week we had a really nice art opening at the British Museum. All the communities that BP has impacted around the world sent items to the British Museum. And we had an activist show at the museum. We just took over and we just set up a show at the museum itself. What that does is they had a new curator. it creates a demand on the curator to accept it into its permanent collection. All right, I'm going to end. Oh, you don't get to see it. All right, I'm going to end with, on May 15th, we are having a rally in Whiting, Indiana, on Whiting Beach. It's called the Break Free from Fossil Fuels Campaign. It's with 350.org and a lot of organizations around here. We've got 30 organizations that have signed on. We expect a minimum of about 1,000 people to come out. So it's going to be a major rally. We're asking them to keep it in the ground. So the idea is, if you squeeze the spigot up at the source, it impacts all the downstream projects in communities of color downstream. So with that, I'm going to pass it on.
All right, I'm going to be brief because I know we want to probably have some dialogue and discussion. I always find myself in this really curious position when I do talks like this, because I always feel rather schizophrenic. Do I speak from my community perspective? Do I speak from a community advocacy perspective? Or do I speak from sort of my academic perspective, right? And those are all three very different perspectives. So I'm going to try and blend the three. I'm not sure if it's going to work or not. But let's see, and you let me know what you think. I come from the mountains of Taos, New Mexico. On my father's side is Native. On my mother's side is a blend. I always am unsure what to say about who I am in these sessions, but I will go ahead with you. My Native name is Changing Woman, which then gives you an idea of how I'm growing into that name, being schizophrenic and doing multiple things in my life. And so how I'm coming to this presentation is really trying to just give you a blend of, from an environmental justice perspective, working from the community side, but also how that helped to shape and inform my work as an academic. If you're from Taos, New Mexico, Los Alamos, New Mexico is just up the road. And for those of you that don't know what Los Alamos, New Mexico represents, Los Alamos is the birthplace of the atomic bomb. And so one of the pressing questions in my entire academic career was, how could science and technology that is supposed to be used for the good be actually used to create one of the most destructive things on the planet? And how could such a thing have been developed completely in secret? And how could such a thing have been developed completely in secret in a sacred place to the people from that community? And that's really what's driven a lot of my questions throughout my career. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put in the context of what the previous speakers have talked about and put it in the context of sort of how we can look at this from a systems perspective, from a global perspective, and from a systems perspective. I'll be fully admit, my area is not in water. My area is in energy policy. So I am framing this around an energy perspective and then hopefully throwing in how that relates to water. So this, for those of you that may not know, is a picture, a graphic that NASA put together of time zones. I believe it's 8 or 10 o'clock at night, right? Pieced together all the different time zones across the world at 10 o'clock at night. Right? So you will see on the planet where electrification has occurred and where electrification has not occurred. If we look at this, we can begin to see, all right, where is an infrastructure for development on the planet, and where is there a lack of infrastructure for development, particularly, as we know, because energy is an essential component for development. You will see in this picture, this might throw some people off, where India is actually lighted completely, right? Have people question, is that true? Does India is it that lit? Well, here's a little bit of cultural dissonance. In their infinite wisdom, NASA put these together on the night of Diwali, which, as many of you know, is the celebration of a festival of lights. And so India completely is lighted up when actually, obviously, its electricity infrastructure is not to that degree. All right, so let's talk about a little bit what it took to create that image right there. And if we take the amount of energy, and I won't get into the technical components, run quickly through, but this is just relatively to show you this graph of exajoules per year, the amount of energy, okay, up until about mid-2000, the amount of energy that it took to create that particular system. That's what the graph you would get. If we were going to be global citizens that believe that everybody should have the exact same access to the exact same kind of development infrastructure in the world, so that means if we were to expand that infrastructure to every country in the world, that's the amount of energy that would be needed by 2100. Obviously, we're living in a life out of balance. When, if you take that, just the non-dotted line, and think about the level of environmental contamination and degradation that has happened just from that historical experience. And if we were to do the same thing to the rest of the world, have the same kind of development capacity that we enjoy right here in the United States, we would be demanding an energy system that basically goes through the roof. That's obviously not something that we want to do. Yet, it is where we're at. If we took, and I'm going to speak from a climate change perspective right now, if we took, because the atmosphere can only hold so much greenhouse gases, right? We all know that. We're potentially on the road to a tipping point. But let's think of it from a perspective of a global citizen. The atmosphere can only store so much carbon dioxide or greenhouse gases. Basically, we've used up about two-thirds of that store, atmospheric store, right? So we have about a third left. And if we calculated, if you said, okay, this is the amount of atmospheric store that we have, and every single person on the planet has as much right to that atmospheric store than any other person, regardless of where they live, regardless of which country they're from, regardless of anything else, because the atmosphere is a commons. Every single person on the planet should have exactly the same right to that store. We did a calculation at the previous academic center that I was at, and that comes to roughly about 3.5, 3.6 tons per person on a global scale of carbon dioxide equivalent. Okay? 3.6 tons per person of carbon dioxide equivalent. So if I were to ask you, what do you think in the United States, what is the per capita average? What would you say? Anybody throw one out?
Six?
Six? What else? 20?
350?
Nope, not that. That's high. So it is about, hovers about 16 to 17 tons per person. Okay, 16 to 17 tons per capita. Now, obviously, that doesn't mean that each one of you uses, admits that. But the infrastructure that you're in, that has been built, whether or not with your choice or without your choice, means that you as a global citizen are responsible for about 16 to 17 tons by living in the United States and being here in the United States of carbon dioxide equivalent. Obviously, there are countries that are much less than that, right? So if we start talking about, for example, Nigeria, what would your guess be? Nigeria has a lot of oil. So what would your guess be? If where the U.S. is 16, 17, what would Nigeria be? About a, yeah, that's about right, okay? About a, less than half to about a ton, right? If you're for a Nigerian person. That's despite the fact that we have imported oil from Nigeria, right? And that's a heavily refined oil. So when we talk on a global scale in terms of ecological debt, this is exactly what we're talking about. As people in the United States and the industrialized world, we have used up the atmosphere historically. Okay? We have an ecological debt to the rest of the world as a result of us using that up. Now, that's not to say that our government thinks the same way, right? Especially when we're in climate negotiations. So what is the complex that has that we use to create that kind of situation? Well, in the U.S. alone, we have about 20,000 power plants that are used to give you the electricity you need for your computers, for your light, for manufacturing, okay, for your daily life. 20,000 power plants. We have about 500,000 miles of high voltage transmission lines. We have 1,300 coal mines, 410 underground natural gas storage fields, 125 nuclear waste storage facilities. In addition to that, we have hundreds of millions of transformers, distribution points, electric motors, electric appliances, 20 million barrels of oil a day, 1,000 refineries, and 1 million gas stations. That's just a summary, right, of the infrastructure that gives you that picture that we were talking about. So when we get to the issue of tar sands and whatnot, this gives you a kind of understanding of where tar sands and petroleum are located within a global system and within our infrastructure in the United States, right? Tar sands and petroleum and petcoke, they are part of, they are a symptom of and a cause of that massive energy infrastructure that we have developed to drive development here in the United States. They are one component. They are by no means the only component. They are one of the dirtiest components. But they are part of a larger system that we have to start rethinking. If we're going to be, if we are going to take the issues of social justice, economic justice, environmental justice seriously, not just within our own communities here domestically, but also across the world. What we do here impacts people across the world. So, you know, tar sands, obviously you've already heard, tar sands is a major issue on First Nation, with First Nation peoples in Canada, right? It creates an enormous problem. Now, I'm not gonna, you know, be light-footed about this. There are some tribes that have agreed to development of tar sands. There are tribes that haven't, First Nations people that haven't. These issues of development pit community against community, precisely because of the access to wealth, access to jobs, access to those things that these communities have rarely had. And we talk about disadvantaged communities. I want to build off of what the previous speakers, because we have heard that term, disadvantaged communities, right? I want to be clear, because sometimes, I know not in this room, but I want, and you know we're all on the same page, but oftentimes and particularly in political and governmental, in the governmental world, agency world, disadvantaged communities become synonymous with communities that don't have power or don't have, or are less than, right? That term is loaded, and unless we clarify it, it becomes this way of creating a second class, right? So environmental justice, just to be clear, environmental justice research has shown over and over again that it's not income, it's not education level, it's not those things that are a primary factor of the disproportionate impacts of pollution. The number one variable is race. So you can be a middle income black community and you will still suffer the effects of environmental pollution. That's why it's called environmental racism, right? So oftentimes we sort of make synonymous environmental justice with purely low income, or as if those communities don't actually have the capacity to deal with these things. I just want to clarify that that's not always the case. Right? So tar sands, what do tar sands do? So this gives you an idea of sort of the greenhouse gas picture, right? And this is from the website. I've modified it from Data is Beautiful, but it gives you an idea of sort of where. So this particular block gives you is the amount of carbon dioxide equivalent that we have emitted, right? Between 1850 and 2000. This green one is the amount of carbon dioxide equivalent that we've added since the year 2000 on a global scale. This gives you an idea of our carbon budget. How much, if we're not going to create havoc, the tipping point, how much we have left, right, to emit. That's our carbon budget. Then it gives you an idea of what we possibly could do, even if we were going to stay on the same path, developing tar sands, developing other types of, right, fossil fuels. And this one gives you how much in fossil fuel reserves exist that right now is owned by all energy companies, okay? This one gives you how much could be developed, and then by companies privately, and then that one gives you sort of generally overall, not just privately owned, but public lands. Remember, public lands are a significant source of oil drilling and mining and exploration. So it gives you an idea of, like, if we do want to use these resources, they are there for our use. But herein lies the, right, the crux. They're there for our use, and what will we be doing to the planet and to communities when that happens? So what are some of the issues around tar sands and toxic pollutions from an environmental justice perspective? Well, for the whole life cycle, and I think folks have already talked about that, so I'm not going to get into it into detail. The whole life cycle of tar sands presents a whole complexity of system pollution issues. From the place that it is mined, which basically destroys, right, talked about, the ecosystem that is there. Very good movie for you all to watch. There's a whole series by Toby McLeod called Sacred Land Project. There's films that document very clearly where the tar sands are in Canada and what's been happening. But there's a whole set of pollutants, toxic pollutants, that gets released purely with the mining, depending on what kind of technology is being used for the extraction of tar sands. Water contaminants, various types of chemicals that all have known developmental impacts, and which in these communities and First Nation communities are experiencing right now, the level of cancer and other kinds of diseases are coming up. Not unlike, though, if we're going to tie this across the world, not unlike the kinds of community health impacts that Mossville, Louisiana, is feeling. Mossville is a community that has also experienced buyout. The petrochemical industry in Mossville, all African American community, has basically created a sacrifice zone in that community, and the health of those community members is deteriorating. But It was a place of, it was a community of that was founded by freed slaves. And I just came from a meeting from with residents of Mossville, some of elders who refused to leave because that was where they founded the community that is so symbolic of another type of oppression that they had experienced. And so even though many of the folks have left and accepted the buyout, you see elders who are refusing to leave because of the significance of place, something that I can relate to very much. We're not going to leave our community in Taos, even though we know that Los Alamos is up the road, and there are all kinds of implications of that. People have already talked about the transport issues with tar sands. But there's also, you know, and I'm not a lawyer, I'm sure our lawyer colleague can speak to this, but the proprietary information of petrochemical companies and energy companies about not having to release the chemicals that are part of the process. So in many of these towns, if somebody becomes sick, either a worker or a community member becomes sick and goes to the hospital, the doctors have no access and no right to figure out what chemical actually they have been exposed to. That's reserved, that's proprietary information in the energy industry. Petrochemical industry has been successful in making that so. So you have whole communities that don't even know what kind of chemicals or pollution are they're being exposed to. Pet coke, a byproduct of the tar sands. You know, the bitumen portion of the diluted mixture contains 102 times more copper, 11 times more nickel, 5 times more lead than conventional crude oils. And then the added diluting agent contains high concentrations of hazardous pollutants such as benzene. So this is from mining, transport, we know there's issues, and then there's the refining, right? Also contains high concentrations of metals including mercury, lead, arsenic, chromium, selenium, vanadium, nickel, which people are exposed to when they breathe the dust blown from petroleum coke piles. So we know these are significant health issues that are affecting the communities that are by them. This, you showed pictures of Indiana. This is actually a picture of Richmond, California, where the refining of dirty crude is taking place. Chevron owns this refinery. It's one of the largest refineries in the country. Environmental justice organizations have been fighting, despite California being, quote unquote, a leader in climate policy at the state level. You will hear about this over and over and over again. This particular refinery has been able to bypass California state policy and regulation over and over and over again. It is located in EJ community, literally fence line separates the community from the refinery. It has experienced numerous types of fires and whatnot. In this particular one, I believe it was 5,000 people had to be evacuated, and an untold number were taken to the hospital, again, because it was unclear what they were breathing in. Petrochemical industry, I think in the opening remarks, we talked about this. Not only are we dealing with the energy side of things, but then we're also, one of the things we have to figure out is the fossil fuel industry is not going to stay stagnant. Right now we have a major lawsuit against the EPA because of a piece of federal regulation that EPA put out, which was to regulate power plants, right? Carbon emissions from power plants. 29 states and industry was successful taking it to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court put a stay on that regulation. So now we don't know what the outcome is going to be, and it has to go back through the courts to make a decision. But essentially, the states, those states have been able to stop any kind of regulation of carbon dioxide emissions from the electric industry for a while, all right? That's the power of industry, not only to be able to work through the legal system, but let's not kid ourselves that if we put a cap on one area of this immense system and infrastructure that we have developed, that those same resources aren't going to be used to try and figure out a profitable use for them. And so at the same time folks are trying to struggle with the energy implications of the petroleum industry and the coal industry, there's a whole petrochemical industry that's happening. And if we stop refining for oil for energy, we still haven't stopped the petrochemical industry part. So environmental justice organizations are really trying to work at all levels of the life cycle of the industry in order to make sure that we actually achieve what we're wanting to achieve. Getting back now full circle to where we started with that global system. We talked about we can stop petcoke, right? We can stop maybe in Indiana, we can stop it in Detroit. But here we have a dilemma. If we're going to be good global citizens, we have to figure out larger and more systemic ways to stop this. This is the refinery marketable pet coke production capacity from 1985 to 2015. It continues to increase, right? Despite the fact that pet coke can't be used in electricity generation, new permits for electricity generation, but it can be still be used in existing power plants, okay? There are several different types of EPA regulations that hopefully make that less and less, that electricity power plants are able to use that less and less because of the co-pollutants that emerges. But new permits for pet coke can't happen, but existing power plants could still use it if they so wished. They would still have to meet regulations, all right? So I don't want to... But this gives you an idea that even as in the U.S., right, we're declining the use of pet coke. It is the highest carbon content energy fuel, beyond coal, beyond anything else. The highest carbon is basically pure carbon, right, that you're burning. So its contribution to climate change, its greenhouse gas, it's a very potent greenhouse gas. And here is, when we're having negotiations at the international level with China and other countries to reduce their greenhouse gas emissions, let's not forget the cycle that's happening here. This is U.S. production of petco. And you can see that our exports of petcoke go to China, Japan, India, Brazil, Turkey, Mexico. So even though we may be getting into international agreements and establish regulations for the reduction of the uses of that energy source in the United States, we are still exporting it across the world. Carbon dioxide is a global pollutant. By sending it to China, we are basically continuing to have an impact on climate change. It won't be registered as a U.S. emission, right? It'll be registered as a Chinese emission. But our role in making that emission happen still continues to exist. So I'll just end there. I just want to say that I thank very much for being invited to come to talk to you. I'm really excited about the Freshwater Lab and all the work that folks are doing here. And I hope that in the future we can continue to work together from an environmental justice perspective. Thanks.
So we have about 20 minutes for questions. The panelists will field their own and, you know, ask a question and save the lengthy statements for the reception. So thanks, everyone.
Yeah, I'll let you guys field them.
I am from Japan, and as all of you know what's going on now in Japan, we had a nuclear power plant accident in Fukushima, Daiichi, and I am from Fukui. Fukui has 15 power plants, of campsite tenure. And also we have two plants of Hokuriku tenure. Can you put up the map for Japan? This information, Japan is importing 9% of the, is totally new information to me. So I really appreciate your representation. But my question to you is that, you know, as you probably all of you know that Japanese government, Abe administration, is determined to the new existing power plants. They initial promise was that after 40 years, it's going to be retired, decommissioned. But they are doing test after test, and claiming that some plants, you know, the life expectancy, you can extend to 60 years. But we are strongly against the Abe administration, determined. So, and also, you know, many Japanese conservatives claiming that restarting the existing power plants properly, 20 power plants, is the only way to reduce the CO2 emission. Okay? But we, as an as I belong to some environmental groups in Japan, so we are totally against the decision and trying to create lots of international movement. And my question to you is that I know that there is a Zion power plant in Chicago, North Chicago. And where is the nuclear waste? Is it going to be permanently waited? And do you still believe in nucleus? Because, you know, what's the future of nuclear energy here in this country?
Well, the future of nuclear energy has now achieved a revival. It is now called the clean energy, right? Mm-hmm. Precisely because it is zero carbon. So in EPA regulations, actually, a nuclear energy is a vital part. It can be used as a replacement for coal power plants.
Totally, yes. It depends on states, government?
No, that's federal regulation. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission is responsible for regulation. So a couple of things are happening. R&D for nuclear power continues. It's been actually upped. Mm-hmm. And so there are some new nuclear power plants that have been proposed in the southeastern part of the United States as an effort to continue to try and increase nuclear power plants. The life of existing nuclear power plants also has been extended. So it's similar to you. And then you had a last, I think I answered your question.
Who makes the decision to shut down,
The Nuclear Regulatory Commission makes a decision to shut down, but it's based on a number of factors, including, a lot of companies have actually extended the life of nuclear power plants. The nuclear waste issue. Waste issue is yet to be resolved. The federal government is responsible for a federal repository.
Yes.
That's Yucca Mountain. Been the site that has been investigated. It is yet to be approved. So right now, nuclear waste is largely stored on site at nuclear power plants.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions?
Yeah. Has light rail from fracking operation replaced the use of Canadian tar sands oil to any degree?
Yeah, I mean.
Can you hear the question? The
question was to what extent fracking has displaced dilbit in the U.S. energy supply. And maybe this is where you're going with your question. We did have my guess is you've got a better handle on the data. But we did have a slight dip in CO2 emissions, largely based on the switch to natural gas, which is less CO2 intensive. The natural gas largely as a result of the fracking technology being utilized. So the short answer is yes. You know, largely I think what we've seen over the past few years is natural gas from fracking has not so much offset the dilbit, but offset coal. So gas prices come down, coupled with what progress we've made to regulate coal emissions has squeezed the electricity sector into moving to natural gas away from coal. As a result, CO2 emissions per unit of energy created has decreased a little bit in the U.S. That's sort of the good news. I guess I'd look at like fracking, frankly, and nuclear. I mean, like I was saying before, I mean, we have an addiction problem with energy, and so you know, fracking and nukes are just methadone.
My question is for Mr. Frank. You mentioned that BP's NPDES permit has that mercury exemption. Do you know how they were able to get that?
Well, a lot of it goes through IDEM, Indiana Department of Environmental Management, and they one of the things that we have in play is it's called incrementalism, and in the event that there is not a efficient low cost solution, they don't have to address that issue, and so they've been exempt in the absence of a low cost solution. Until one can be found, and yet they were required to fund Argonne National Labs and Purdue some projects to develop some technology, and they actually is starting to come online some options, but they won't clean it up entirely.
So I have a question for Dr. Martinez about the sort of like atmospheric carbon banks.
Could you? I have a dinging ear.
Okay. So the question is about the atmospheric carbon bank, right? So we have theoretically this one third left, right? But presumably, you know, to a certain extent, that this carbon is being sort of like processed back into the ground at a very slow rate, but the other part of the equation here would be like rapid deforestation, right? Actually, is reducing the atmosphere's ability or our ability to process those emissions back. So in some sense, like that one third is maybe even a bit high in the sky. But so yeah, I mean, maybe you could sort of talk more about like the way in which those even that sort of like the presentation of that statistic is like maybe not painting the whole picture of how drastic it is.
Sure. Yeah, and that obviously is a very simplified, but I would also say that you know on the one hand, our science is getting better and better. On the other hand, remember these are complex atmospheric and ecosystem types of modeling that have to happen. So on the one hand, yes, obviously we have a cycle of carbon. There's a number of other issues in terms of sequestration of carbon and in soil, you know, in trees. There's the blue carbon issue with oceanic waters. So these are complex systems that we have to constantly be modeling and evaluating exactly where, you know, where we're at. You know, depending on which models, and that's why the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, you will see that they have, you know, high certainty, medium certainty, low certainty. I mean, there are great ranges. Even the best scientific expertise isn't precise. We have ranges of certainty about where and how certain ecosystems and what's happening with carbon. So absolutely. I think from an environmental justice perspective, and didn't talk about that, but you know, that's what we always ask, when did climate change begin? You know, did it begin with when we began to discover it scientifically? Did it begin when we actually expanded our highway system and rapidly increased our oil-based transportation, which also had implications for communities of color that were devastated by that highway construction? Did it begin when we created suburban housing and all kinds of buildings that are highly energy intensive and also, by the way, had racial covenants and implications for that? Did it begin? You know, we have a saying in Indian country, I know it's a funny just little joke that we have running around, but situation would be different if we had better border control in 1492. So did it begin with the denuding of virgin forests, right? That began, you know, earlier than the Industrial Revolution. So I think all of those we take into account when we're doing ecological and social environmental justice.
Yeah. I'd agree, and actually, you know, Tom had a great line that if anything that we said could come true, it was just, it's that, I mean, I've worked on climate change stuff, you know, for whatever it is now, like 15 years, and it just frustrates me so much that we have not been able to marry environmental justice with 350.org. I mean, you know, on the one hand, there's all this concern about atmospheric CO2 levels, and it's a very out there problem. It's really long term. It's really diffuse. I know because I've done the organizing work on it. It's really hard to get people to give a shit about it because it's just literally out there and up there. But then on the other hand, we see the effects of our oil addiction, you know, literally destroying our communities. I mean, you're physically destroying our communities. And we have not been able to marry that, you know, that on the ground horrific impact that's right here and now with the long term of the 350 and the climate change. And I mean, we really have, you know, we have ourselves to look at for failing to do that. I mean, you know, it's a tough job to get people to care about a problem that's going to impact you in 20 years and in distant places. But we have not been able to use the fact that, you know, however many people died near a refinery last year to do that. And it's just been a huge frustration within the environmental community.
And I just want to follow up with that. I think there is a great amount of environmental justice work on climate. The People's Climate March, which 350.org get a lot of credit for, please don't make the mistake of knowing that the reason that you got that 400,000 people there was because a lot of environmental justice organizations were part of organizing that march. They may not be heard about, because then who gets the credit for doing that? But that wouldn't have happened without, and intentionally you will see it's a very diverse march. So on the one hand, yes, I agree with you, but on the other hand, I think there is a vibrant climate justice movement that doesn't make the media, but they are having very important wins and very important actions happening as well.
Yeah, one of the things to think about in terms of the climate justice, environmental justice, to think about that is the climate justice movement has become kind of a sexy thing for a lot of white liberals, but the idea is, but for the problem in EJ communities, we wouldn't have the aggregate problem of climate justice. If we wouldn't allow that to occur in particular places to particular peoples.
Yeah.
I would just like to say that I think there's a really critical issue that I wish the environmental community and foundations would work on, which is money and politics. You guys mentioned the Koch brothers multiple times. We can have all the battles we want about money and politics on both sides, but that's a huge driver. It's a huge driver, and it's very much about those people and their desire to break laws and make money.
Yeah, absolutely.
When it comes to money, the one thing I like to think, because we're now becoming aware of it, we're talking about companies are too big to fail, banks are too big to fail, but we haven't found an ecosystem that was too big to fail. We've destroyed so many of them to the point where we're destroying the entire climate of the planet.
Can I respond to that, actually? Because one of the things that's really hopeful is they're actually doing that right now. So over 900 people and a lot of the executive directors of environmental organizations like the one I work for have been arrested in Washington, D.C. outside of the Capitol in the last
about a week or two ago. It's
yeah,
about time.
It's still happening.
Yeah, I know. That group is good. And we just got to do it way more. It's the environmental groups, and I've been involved also a long time, absolutely support some of the people who are in that. We were, the environmental white liberals were very late to even speak to our fellows who are in the communities that have suffered most. They weren't at the table, they weren't at lobby days for the Great Lakes over the years, they weren't at a whole lot of meetings like this, right? And that is still true, and the idea of the money in politics, but it's specifically the Kochs, so that's part of my point. Okay, we don't need, it really is clearly, I mean, physical evidence, we're breathing in what they've done to us, and that's, how can you not talk about that at every environmental issue? So I applaud going to Washington, sitting on the front steps and causing attention to it, and we gotta talk about that all the time through November and past then. They own the messaging on lots of this.
So maybe just before, excuse me, we break and go to the reception, each of the panelists, all here from out of town or just nearby, want to end with some final words and takeaways from us, and then if we won't end, we'll just move into more casual conversation. So, yes, Thomas, you want to start?
As much as I give a dire story about my community, one thing that's kind of interesting coming here is the freshwater lab here is like, how do I say, enviro positive in community. There's no shaming in a way, and I give a very dire story and a very heightened story about my community in that region. I'm actually positive about a lot of things that are happening in terms of the activist community. I think we're seeing lots of changes. I think there are serious challenges. I like that the Sierra Club said that they were going to lock down against a phantom pipeline, but not against a real one. I have problems with that. They're not locking down anymore. And we have some real infrastructure that we really have to go after. So we're looking for what we're calling a just transition. We really have to find ways in which we move these communities into a low-carbon economy, and the jobs that are related to that. And that's the challenge right now.
Final thoughts. I don't know. You know, I have to admit that I'm stuck at the moment, precisely, I think, because of what you were talking about there in terms of the politics and whatnot. I agree. You know, I just came back from a series of meetings with my fellow friends, environmental justice folks, some of the people that gave birth to environmental justice, Bob Ward, Wright, you know, Richard Moore, all these sort of old guard fighters, and we were sitting around talking about things, and, you know, there's hope, and on the other hand, you know, these folks, you know, are now in their late 60s, early 70s, and are sitting there saying, you know, the exact same problems that we were fighting, you know, in the 1980s are the problems that we're fighting right now. And it has to do with what you were saying. It's sort of figuring out how we can empower communities, all communities, local communities, to speak for themselves and have a voice in the democratic system that is about them being able to choose what they want in their community and how they want it. You know, environmental justice communities aren't ever about saying, not in my backyard, but it's okay in your backyard. That's not what it's about. And I think if we can just figure out how to work together
maybe we can get there. But yeah, that, we're all stuck right now, admittedly so.
Yeah, I'd agree. I've done this work for probably longer than it seems, and I guess I've kind of come to the view that environmental problems are a symptom of a broken society. Mm-hmm. We're probably not going to solve environmental problems. We're probably going to have to fix a broken society, and then we're going to, you know, we need to be at peace with each other, and we need to be at peace with our surroundings. And when that happens, environmental problems will start to become solved. But right now, they're a symptom.
Okay, join me in thanking